corruption. It's a word that we hear a lot, but what does it mean? For most of us, our experience comes from the media and headlines, such as former public official imprisoned after falsifying documents, senior official caught red-handed accepting bribes, witnesses questioned at corruption inquiry into missing millions. But to better understand the concept, think about some of the decisions that public officials make as part of their job. They set budgets and allocate funding, build and maintain infrastructure, give approvals to develop property, use natural resources, or operate a business, enforce the law, buy billions of dollars worth of goods and services from the private sector by allocating tenders, contracts, and purchase orders. They also hold a great deal of information about upcoming projects, budgets, the intellectual property of suppliers, and other data that is personal or confidential. Many of these decisions involve transferring something of value into private hands. Public officials are required to make these decisions in the best interests of the people of New South Wales. But if they use their position to create benefits for themselves or their associates, then they may be acting corruptly. In New South Wales, the Independent Commission Against Corruption, or ICAC, is responsible for exposing and preventing corruption in the public sector. It has considerable covert and coercive powers to investigate allegations of serious or systemic corrupt conduct. The official definition of corruption is defined in Section 7, 8, and 9 of the Independent Commission Against Corruption Act 1988. But in general, corruption by a public official involves conduct that is intentionally dishonest, biased or partial, is a breach of public trust, or involves a misuse of information or materials. In essence, corruption involves the deliberate abuse of public office. Here's an example. A government IT manager needs to purchase a server and a small, inexpensive one will suffice. But the manager engages a hardware vendor and they agree to install a larger, more expensive server so the two of them can personally split the additional profit from the sale. In this case, there is clear evidence of corrupt conduct because it is deliberate, dishonest, and partial conduct that results in a loss of funds from the agency. Importantly, it is not only government employees that can be corrupt. Under the ICAC Act, contractors or suppliers could be classified as public officials if their work is for or on behalf of the government. Members of the public can also engage in corrupt conduct if they influence or try to influence a New South Wales public official to use his or her position in a way that is dishonest or partial. For instance, if they paid a bribe in order to pass a driver's license test. Some conduct that impairs public confidence in government can also be corrupt. This includes collusive tendering. For example, two suppliers conspiring to increase prices and rip off a public sector agency. Fraud in relation to applications for certain licenses, permits, or authorities, such as a property developer submitting false information as part of a development application. Dishonestly obtaining public funds. For example, a supplier submitting a false invoice. Defrauding public revenue, such as a business deliberately underpaying its payroll tax. Submitting a false job application. For example, a candidate for a public sector job pretending to have a doctorate from a prestigious university. Finally, conduct is only considered corrupt if it is serious. Generally, it needs to be serious enough to be a crime, a disciplinary offence, or grounds for dismissal. So, now you know what corruption is. If you see or suspect corruption involving the New South Wales public sector, it is important to speak up about it. For more information, visit the ICAC at icac.nsw.gov.au.